Buenas tardes y bienvenidos a IE University. Good evening and welcome to IE University. I'm the president of this university and we are very proud to have you all here. Thanks to all of you, the authorities, ambassadors present here, to all the members of the staff of the Hay Festival. Let me now turn into English, sorry, into Spanish, para agradecer también la presencia de todos los embajadores, de las autoridades, de los miembros de distintos organismos e instituciones, también de los voluntarios de IE University que están colaborando para garantizar que el servicio durante estos días sea excelente. Es la décima edición del festival. Conmemoramos esta décima edición con un programa y unos contenidos únicos, muy intensos, unos ponentes de primera línea. Yo quería agradecer la colaboración de todos los presidentes, copresidentes, covicepresidentes del GEI, pero muy en particular quería pedirles a todos un aplauso para la organizadora del festival, María Sheila Cremasi, que es realmente el alma del GEI Festival aquí en Segovia. And allow me now to say, permítame que diga algo en inglés, teniendo en cuenta también la asistencia de personas internacionales sobre nuestra universidad. IE University was once described by the Financial Times as an unusual university with unusual people. You know, at first I wasn't sure whether this was a praise, a positive thing or a criticism, but I guess that it describes very well the way we are. We are unusual in terms of the students. We have 106 different nationalities on campus. We are unusual in terms of the faculty, also very talented because they not just develop research, but they excel also in consultancy and in their respective professions. And of course, we have an unusual campus, this wonderful campus of Santa Cruz La Real here in Segovia, as well as our campus in Madrid. Lo que espero es que disfruten del Festival GEI en estos días, disfruten también de nuestro campus. Y sin más voy a ceder la palabra a Pablo Vázquez, presidente de Renfe, quien en nombre de todos los patrocinadores del festival les va a dirigir también la palabra. Muchas gracias.
Buenas tardes a todos. Good afternoon. Quería muy brevemente, porque creo que no hemos venido a escuchar a los patrocinadores, sino a las personas que van a intervenir hoy, quería simplemente manifestar mi satisfacción y la de todos los patrocinadores, todos los sponsors, por tener la oportunidad de colaborar con este evento. ¿Por qué para una compañía como Renfe, y que es la que me toca ahora a mí presidir, es importante estar aquí? Yo creo que con mi presencia y la presencia de otros directores de la empresa hemos querido estar aquí porque queremos transmitir que Renfe, que el futuro de nuestra empresa no es solo o no pasa solo por tener muy buenos trenes que sean capaces de llevarnos muy rápido como nos han llevado esta tarde aquí a Segovia, sino también pasa por cuidar el talento, el capital humano de las personas que en el futuro tienen que ser capaces de continuar con la tarea que estamos haciendo nosotros ahora de servicio público. Eso es muy bueno con gente y con entidades como el Instituto de Empresa, que es una de las principales entidades en el mundo en la formación de directivos, y nosotros necesitamos directivos de esos para sacar adelante la empresa. Y además aquí se va a hablar de muchas cosas que a Renfe le importan. Especialmente esta tarde vamos a hablar de medio ambiente. Pensamos en Renfe, toda la energía que consumimos hoy es energía renovable y nos sentimos muy orgullosos de que así sea, pero pensamos que podemos contribuir, si cabe más, a la sostenibilidad del medio ambiente. Y, por tanto, queremos aprender. Nos parece que aquí es la antena para entender cómo va a ir el futuro. Y por eso nos sentimos muy orgullosos y pensamos que es una gran inversión estar aquí presentes. Y nada más. Muchas gracias.
It is now my pleasure to hand over to His Excellency, the Ambassador of the UK, Simon Manley, who's going to introduce the next panel. Of course, The ambassador is one incondicional here at the Hay Festival. You have been attending this festival since you were actually appointed to this office. So we are very proud to have you here. And without further ado, I'll hand over to you. Thanks very much.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias, Santiago. Y quisiera dar gracias para sus palabras y su presentación, así como también dar las bienvenidas a todos ustedes hoy aquí a la maravillosa ciudad de Sevilla y a este magnífico recinto de Segovia, de Segovia, y este magnífico recinto a la Festival Hay Festival Segovia de 2015. Un acontecimiento de este tipo requiere tantísimo trabajo y encima el Hay Festival Segovia de este año promete ser mejor que nunca. Y quisiera trasladar un especial agradecimiento a la alcaldesa de Segovia por su generoso apoyo a este festival y a los organizadores de los actos que están organizados para hoy. La Universidad IE, el país, Renfe, la Fundación Banco Sabadell, British Council, así como una larga lista de 90 colaboradores sin cuya participación esto no hubiera sido posible. Y por último, aunque no por ello es menos importante, al famoso Sheila Cremache y todos aquellos en IE que hacen un trabajo tan fabuloso año tras año. Y ahora, con la jornada de esta noche en mente, les ruego que me disculpen por continuar hablando en inglés. In these moments, when Europe faces this dramatic migration crisis on its borders, as tens of thousands of people flee conflict across the Middle East, flee the barbarism of Daesh and the Assad regime, flee the conflicts in Libya, and flee poverty and ill governance across so many parts of Africa, Middle East, and Asia. A crisis which touches our hearts as Europeans and calls upon us to mount a European-wide response to treat not just the symptoms, but also the causes of this crisis. It's easy to forget some of the other challenges that Europe faces. The challenges of putting more than 20 million young Europeans back to work, of creating a European economy that is fit to compete with the emerging and emerged economies of Asia and Latin America. And yes, the challenge of climate change, which we are discussing here this evening. A challenge which is already changing the lives of people across the planet and which threatens to change the lives of millions more if we do not act now to stem its worst effects. The Paris conference, later this autumn, is a milestone in international efforts on this issue. And it should be an occasion when we as Europeans step up to the challenge of global leadership, working with our partners across the globe to finalize the first truly global agreement to limit greenhouse gas emissions, to create a strong, ambitious, rules-based agreement that can make the shift to a clean, green, global economy irreversible, and to work in conjunction with public and private sectors to affect that goal. And I think there could be no better a panel to debate how we are going to do that than the panel that has been assembled here this evening. Manuel Planeres from El País is going to moderate these figures from across the climate change community. Samantha Smith, leader of the Global Climate and Energy Initiative for the World Wildlife Fund International, Alexander Lech, Chief of Education for Sustainable Development at UNESCO. Teresa Ribera, former Secretary of State for Energy, a good friend of our embassy, and now Director of the Institute for Sustainable Development and International Relations. And James Randerson, journalist at our very own Guardian, in charge of Keep It On The Ground campaign. My thanks to all of them for being here this evening. My thanks to all of you to be here in this marvelous city, in this marvelous university. Thank you very much indeed, and good luck.
Muchas gracias por venir aquí y muchas gracias por escucharnos sobre algo que a todos los que estamos aquí nos preocupa y en lo que trabajamos habitualmente. La Agencia Estadounidense de la Atmósfera y los Océanos esta misma semana ha publicado uno de sus informes mensuales y nos vuelve a alertar de que este mes de agosto ha sido el más cálido desde que tienen registros, desde 1880. Esto está ocurriendo en los últimos meses de forma escalonada, o sea, cada mes que estamos terminando es el más cálido desde que hay registros. La evidencia ahora mismo de que hay un calentamiento en el planeta no lo niega nadie. Como hay muy poquita gente que niegue que el hombre está detrás de ese calentamiento, fundamentalmente porque estamos emitiendo más gases de efecto invernadero en el planeta que lo que el planeta puede asumir. Ahora estamos en un momento crítico respecto a este asunto. Estamos ante la decisión de si vamos a ser una generación que conocíamos el problema, que conocíamos el problema del calentamiento y no hicimos nada o hicimos algo. Y la reunión de diciembre de París va a ser clave. Va a ser clave para fijar las estrategias para dejar de emitir tanto dióxido de carbono a la atmósfera, es decir, para intentar evitar que el planeta se caliente más. Y lo que me gustaría saber es si nuestros ponentes consideran que París va a ser el punto de inflexión. Es decir, ¿París va a ser el comienzo de una era de descarbonización en el planeta? Samantha.
Okay. So thank you, Manu. As you said, we're living in a historic moment, but not in a good way. So we're experiencing a warmer planet than we've ever experienced. And these heat waves that have blanketed Europe over the summer, these have effects that we don't even think about. For example, everyone who works outside, people who work in construction, in building infrastructure, people working in agriculture, old people and children, they're all deeply affected by heat, and it also affects productivity. I think that we really are at a kind of tipping point, because if we don't act on climate change now, what we can expect is that over the next few decades, what we experience as the hottest summer ever will become the new average temperature. So we really are facing something, a change that's really enormous within our lifetimes. Now, on the other hand, we're also living in a historic moment because we're starting to see an energy transition. What we need to do in order to fix dangerous climate change is to stop using fossil fuels and to start using renewable energy. You won't just hear that from activists such as myself, you'll hear this from scientists and business people. And we're starting to see that energy transition. And I will go so far as to say that within my lifetime, if I'm a bit lucky and don't get hit by a bus or an electric vehicle, we will see the end of coal. We will see a revolution in transportation. We will see the creation of millions and millions of green new jobs, jobs that don't even exist today. We will see all of these things. So we are balancing between these two things. And what Paris can do for us is it cannot stop this development that is already happening. We think, as WWF, there will be an agreement in Paris. Will that agreement be enough to keep us from experiencing a rapidly warming planet with all of the impacts on people and nature that we know will come? No. And no one UN agreement can do that. But we see already throughout society, in different countries, in China, in the European Union, even in the United States, we see that this change is starting to happen, and we think that what happens in Paris can accelerate it.
James, please. Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed for inviting me here to speak. I want to thank the organizers. Earlier this summer, I was talking on a panel at the Glastonbury Music Festival about climate change. And looking out to the audience, I can see that you're considerably more smartly dressed. I'm just about to see you. And a lot less muddy, and I think a bit less drunk, but maybe that will change later on. But that was proof to me that climate change is now officially rock and roll, but in this environment, it's something else entirely. In answer to the question, is Paris or will Paris be the beginning of something special? I think that it's already happening around the world. The low carbon economy is happening in a way that it wasn't so much in Copenhagen in 2009. At that point, it was, you know, largely a PowerPoint presentation, but you know, it's now a reality on the ground, and that is driving the politicians to be more ambitious. And it means what Paris has to achieve, though, is to set the direction so that that progress continues and accelerates. I wanted to tell you a little story about where The Guardian newspaper fits into all of this. Cast your minds back to December last year, to Christmas Eve. What were you doing on Christmas Eve? You were probably at home, maybe wrapping some last-minute presents or having a few glasses of some mulled wine. Well, I was doing all of those things, but stupidly, I looked at my work email, which is always a bad idea, and there was an email there from the editor of The Guardian, the then editor, Alan Rusbridger, who had emailed me and a group of other people in the organization. It had recently been announced that he was finishing his editorship after 20 years, and he had a few months left in post, and he said, with that time, I want to do something impactful on climate change. And so he was saying, I want everyone to put their heads together and think what we should do as an organization that would start to turn the heat up on the politicians before Paris in this kind of crucial year. And so after Christmas, we got together many journalists from different bits of the organization and other people, and we discussed what we should do. And we decided to start a campaign, or, well, more accurately, join a campaign that is out there in the world and is having an incredible impact. And that is fossil fuel divestment. As you may know, many, many organizations, universities, philanthropic funds, churches, all sorts of organizations have begun to move their money, their investments, away from contributors to climate change, from the producers of oil, coal, and gas, and into alternatives. And this campaign has had an incredible impact. It's just exploded over the last year. And all sorts of organizations are now on board, including the Church of England, the Rockefeller Brothers, who, of course, made their money through Standard Oil, the Norway Sovereign Wealth Fund, and so on. So in March, we launched this campaign and made a big push on two organizations in particular, the Gates Foundation and the Wellcome Trust, the two largest health charities in the world. But we also made a commitment to journalism on climate change, which was sort of in parallel to the campaign. We made a commitment to do lots of reporting and investigation on that topic that has continued. And also the Guardian divested its own fund, which is around €1 billion. The progress that has happened in the meantime is really remarkable. The number of organizations now that have joined the divestment club is approaching 400, and the total worth of those organizations is somewhere north of $2 trillion. So this is serious money, and it's civil society putting its money where its mouth is and saying, making a signal to politicians that they are serious about this issue and they want the right signals from the politicians so that we can make this massive transition of our economy away from dirty energy to clean energy. So that's just part of the things that are happening on the ground. It's not sufficient on its own. Divestment is only part of many things that have to happen, but it's just one example I wanted to highlight because The Guardian has been so involved with it. And incidentally, if you're interested in the campaign, you can sign up and hear more about it. If you find my Twitter feed, I tweeted the link where you can sign up today, or you can Google Keep It in the Ground. Thanks very much.
Perfecto. Teresa.
Muchas gracias, Manuel, y muchísimas gracias a los organizadores por esta invitación para conversar en tan fantástico sitio sobre tan fantástico tema con estos fantásticos compañeros. Yo creo que tu pregunta fundamentalmente es hasta qué punto París marca un antes y un después en este fin de la era de los combustibles fósiles. Y me parece que tanto Samantha como James han dado algunas pistas sobre las que voy a construir algunas ideas. En primer lugar, porque creo, como señalaba Samantha, que esa transición, ese inicio del fin de la era de los combustibles fósiles está en marcha. Hay algunos indicios, no tanto porque se acabe la cantidad de combustibles fósiles, como porque hay otras alternativas técnicamente viables a un precio razonable, competitivo, que tendrán que ordenar un modelo de negocio diferente, pero están ahí, disponibles y satisfacen las necesidades de la gente de una manera mucho más solvente y con menos efectos secundarios. Porque hay una reacción, que es lo que ha destacado James, que es muy interesante, y es hasta qué punto, desde el punto de vista de la viabilidad financiera y la percepción de los inversores de medio y largo plazo, hay una creciente convicción de que pueden ser inversiones extraordinariamente arriesgadas y que no se está midiendo bien el riesgo de una excesiva exposición a una intensidad de carbono, a unos combustibles que, si queremos de verdad garantizar la seguridad, la paz, la seguridad en la tierra, deberían quedar en mucha mayor medida bajo tierra, o si son utilizados, debería hacerse en unas condiciones que garantizaran que no hubiera emisiones de gases de efecto invernadero. Por tanto, hay una reacción del sector financiero que está empezando a aprender a evaluar los riesgos y las oportunidades de dónde colocar su dinero de una manera diferente. Y yo creo que porque hay un movimiento social al que aludía también James, hay una percepción social que está cambiando. Yo creo que la energía ha sido siempre entendida, concebida como un factor de prosperidad, de bienestar, y hay una intención de que esto siga así y, por tanto, de evitar que nuestra respuesta o nuestro consumo energético, en lugar de ser fuente de prosperidad, sea fuente de conflicto o fuente de daño, ¿no? Yo creo que esto se ve pues, en las respuestas energéticas en ciudades supercontaminadas como China y como Pekín y los problemas de salud pública, pero esos otros aspectos también un poquito más globales como es la puesta en riesgo del sistema climático. Por tanto, por estas tres razones, porque hay alternativas técnicas viables, porque hay una percepción diferente de los riesgos financieros y de la necesidad de invertir nuestro dinero de manera segura y porque hay un rechazo social creciente, como en su momento lo hubo con el tabaco, con la esclavitud, con otros grandes cambios en nuestra historia de la humanidad, el proceso está en marcha. Todavía no 100% visible, pero el proceso está en marcha. Si este cambio es inevitable, si los gobiernos entienden que este cambio es inevitable, la gran pregunta es: ¿esperamos a que los efectos sean tan terribles que tengamos que reaccionar poniendo parches o intentamos gestionar colectivamente de una manera más inteligente ese cambio, velando porque la transición, que no ocurrirá de un día para el otro, probablemente serán décadas de transformación, sea la transición más inteligente posible, tutelando, garantizando medidas de protección a quienes pueden ser más vulnerables, buscando cuáles son las oportunidades de reinventar nuestro modelo de desarrollo de otra manera y aprendiendo a trabajar sobre la base de una confianza en nuestro esfuerzo colectivo como países, como sociedades, identificando dónde pueden estar las dificultades, identificando dónde pueden estar los puntos en los que una mayor colaboración ayuda a superar determinadas barreras. Por eso yo creo que París fundamentalmente lo que tiene que responder es a este reto. Si de verdad París es capaz de establecer un sistema que con el tiempo pueda considerarse como ese referente que ayudó a encauzar esa voluntad de trabajar de un modo diferente para el conjunto de la humanidad, para aprender hacerlo de un modo más inteligente, para actuar como un catalizador que acelera ese proceso de cambio. Yo creo que la voluntad existe, no es un proceso sencillo, pero mi impresión es que hay una convicción muy extendida sobre la importancia de que esto sea así. No es que no pueda ser de otra manera, pero es mucho más inteligente hacerlo de forma cooperativa y cuanto antes que no esperar a que cada cual vaya resolviendo los problemas según le van surgiendo y afrontándolos de manera individual.
Thank you, Manuel. And also from my side, thank you very much for the invitation. It's really a privilege to be here at this opening and talk. And also thank you for choosing the ever crucial topic of climate change. I think the Paris Agreement will be, of course, hugely important. But I think we will have to see as part of a process. And I agree with my fellow panelists that I think we put the Paris Agreement in the right perspective if we really see it as part of a process that has started long ago, but that will also continue after the Paris conference. Because in many respects, we already know now that the Paris Agreement, as successful as it may be, in some aspects overall, will not be enough. So it will be very important to continue the process afterwards. And my fellow panelists have given some indications how this process can continue. I think one real achievement of the Paris Agreement I think we already have now, and it's not only of the Paris Agreement, but in fact of the whole way that led towards Paris, and not only throughout this year, but over the last years of the climate conferences, I would even say including the failure of Copenhagen. I think quite independent of all the technical details that are being discussed in the climate change conferences, I think it was a huge help to raise awareness of the issue. The very fact that once per year the highest levels, normally the highest levels of government came together to discuss these issues, I think that generated a lot of action and a lot of visibility. So in that sense, and of course, like as a UN official, I'm happy to say that I think it's actually one of the, in a way, one of the more successful UN processes, I think, because it certainly has increased to the to raising the awareness about the issue. And the other perspective I have on the Paris Agreement from the side of UNESCO, from, as you know, the UN entity, the UN agency that is responsible for education, culture, science and communication, is to see how Paris will support these seemingly soft topics, soft policy issues in the climate process, and particularly important, we regard education as a sensitizer and a supporter of the way towards sustainable development. And I think there are also some positive indications at the last climate change conference in Lima. The direct predecessor to Paris, we had a very, very strong declaration, a strong international policy statement on the importance of education and awareness raising to combat climate change. So also from that perspective, there are some positive signs.
En vuestras intervenciones, todos habéis coincidido en que es un proceso que ya está en marcha. Y efectivamente, cuando ves el mix energético de cada país, ves que las renovables van ganando terreno muy, muy rápidamente. La cuestión, y lo que me gustaría que me comentaseis, es cuándo se va a dar ese paso hacia el transporte, fundamentalmente hacia el transporte rodado, que más o menos es aproximadamente un tercio, es responsable de aproximadamente de un tercio del CO2 que se emite a la atmósfera. ¿Cuándo y cómo creéis que se va a conseguir descarbonizar también el transporte? Samantha.
So first of all, I must apologize. I was so excited to talk about climate change, I forgot to thank the organizers for having me here. So thank you. I want to build a little bit on what my fellow panelists said. And first, I also want to say one thing. Listening to this panel, you would think everything is fine. It's all in order. There's an energy transition coming. The UN is doing a great job. The NGOs are doing their part. We don't like fossil fuels. They're going to stay in the ground. And I want to say to you that we are at the start of an energy transition. We're in the middle of a struggle. We don't know how long that struggle is going to last. We don't know when we're going to get sudden victories, but we know that it has started. And if you had talked to any of us 5 years ago, we would have said, the transition hasn't started. We feel really despairing about what's happening. So just to make that absolutely clear. When it comes to transportation, this week I had the privilege of speaking to global trade unions at a trade union and climate summit in Paris. And it might surprise you to hear that workers from a range of industries, including the automotive industry, they also see this transition coming. And so we had workers from coal unions in Australia, from Canada, saying that they know that fossil fuels are going, and their workers must now be trained for new jobs of the future. You have to do something about people's pensions. You have to take care of communities that have relied on some industries and also on mining. The reason why I mention this is that there are a lot of people employed right now in the automotive industry of the past. And what we're seeing, not only from workers, but also from car manufacturers, because WWF is also talking a lot to some of the world's biggest car manufacturers, is that we're on the edge of a big transition in transport. So one sign of that is that BMW has committed, I think, to have all of its offerings, all of its products, all of its cars electric or hybrid by something like 2025 or 2030. So they're first out of the box, but other car manufacturers are also starting to think, okay, we're going to go electric in a very big way. So in terms of transport, we see a few things that are already happening, but that will accelerate. One is that young people, the age of my children, they don't really want to own cars. So they're actually not so interested in the idea of cars. They would like to have something that comes and gets them. You know, when they want to be picked up, they like public transport, they like to walk. It's called mom and dad, but you know, at some point one must stop driving them around, especially if you're an activist. So there is a tendency in many countries for young people not to want to own cars. The second thing is the development of new business models such as Uber. Now, you know, there are lots of things you might not like about Uber, especially if you're working in transport and that's your job to drive people around, and here you're seeing people who are getting worse wages, they're not organized and so forth. But still we're seeing the idea that you don't have to own a car in order to have personal transport. We will see driverless cars. That will be another thing that will contribute to people owning fewer cars, because then you don't have to, you know, you call it, you order it on the app, it comes and gets you. And I think the last thing that we'll see is much, much more collective transport driven by electricity, so high-speed trains and so on. And all of these things are starting to happen, but they need to happen very rapidly indeed. And in this process, as Teresa was saying, it can be chaotic and in some ways terrible, in the same way that the Industrial Revolution was chaotic and terrible for a lot of people on the sharp, pointy end of change. Or We can try to plan it to the greatest extent possible, try to have a plan for workers, try to create new jobs for young people. I'll say one last thing about this just transition, as we call it. So a fair, a just transition, not only for the people who are affected by climate change, but for people who are going to be participating in the new economy. The Spanish unions have produced a very helpful report, which shows that with a move to decentralized renewable energy, you could get pretty much immediately something like 120,000, 130,000 jobs created here in Spain. Now, it's up to Spanish employers and the Spanish government and also the unions to be sure that these are good jobs, jobs that build prosperity, that give people decent wages. But what we know from other parts of the world is that renewable energy creates jobs, and it is increasingly, in many places, much cheaper than fossil fuels. So in this, you know, we mustn't just think about fighting climate change as suffering and chaining ourselves to things. It's also about job creation. It's also about things that are exciting also for young workers.
Point that she started with, that there's nothing inevitable about this, is a very good one. And there's a journalistic dilemma, actually, for the likes of The Guardian, because on the one hand, one has to be straight with people about the scale of the challenge, and to be straight with people about what the science is saying. And the scale of the challenge, you know, the reason we're talking about keeping it in the ground is because if you look at how much proven fossil fuels there are in the world and work out how much you would need to take us or have a reasonable chance of taking us over the 2-degree warming threshold, we need to keep somewhere between 4/5 and 2/3 under the ground, so that, you know, the majority, and that is the stuff we already know about, let alone the stuff that the companies are spending trillions of dollars or will be spending over the coming decade or so of investors' money looking for. So there's that side of things, and the science can often be quite depressing. And we find that readers quite often, you know, want to kind of curl up in a ball and stop listening. So that's why things like, you know, the divestment movement are interesting and dynamic, because there is real hope there, and I think there's genuine grounds for hope that that Paris will achieve something. Because of these sort of bottom-up forces that are happening at the moment that were not there or were much weaker at Copenhagen. On the question of transport, of course, this is the really tricky one, because electricity is easier. I mean, electricity is really hard as well, but transport is even harder, because, you know, changing the entire vehicle fleet to electric cars or hydrogen, if that's the way people want to go, is incredibly hard to do and takes time. And frankly, there just isn't really the technology on the medium horizon for aviation to help us. So the prospects for transportation are harder, and making predictions is also harder. I mean, it's worth remembering that back in 2011, Renault-Nissan were predicting that they would have 1.5 million electric vehicles on the road by now. Anyone want to have a guess at the reality? It's much lower. It's 250,000. So there have been some bold predictions in the past that haven't come true. But the upside is that the electric vehicle market in Europe is growing very rapidly, at something like 37% in 2014. But still, it's a tiny proportion of the market, less than 1% of new registrations at the moment. So we're at the beginning of a process with transport and transforming the electricity supply with renewables and potentially with nuclear, although there's all sorts of cost issues with nuclear and it takes incredibly long time. The solutions there look easier than transport. So you've picked on perhaps the hardest bit of the equation.
Yo creo, Manuel, que es muy difícil dar una respuesta precisa, concreta, a tu pregunta directa. ¿Cuándo se va a resolver el asunto del transporte? Pero sí creo que, en línea con lo que han dicho mis compañeros, hay algunas referencias importantes que ayudan a dar una imagen del abanico de elementos para dar respuesta a tu pregunta. En primer lugar, ¿de qué estamos hablando? Yo creo que Samantha ha hecho bien en subrayar que en realidad de lo que hablamos es de necesidades de movilidad. Es decir, nos hemos enamorado de los coches y nos estamos desenamorando porque estamos encontrando que hay otras muchas alternativas que se pueden gestionar de una manera mucho más inteligente. No es lo mismo cubrir las necesidades de movilidad en distancias cortas que en distancias largas. No es imprescindible tener en propiedad el instrumento que te va a llevar a la movilidad de las distancias medias y las distancias largas. Eso tiene que ver con cómo se piensan, diseñan las ciudades y las necesidades de los ciudadanos para poder desplazarse convenientemente, tanto de una manera mucho más sana, como es haciendo ejercicio, como a través de soluciones de transporte público. Tiene que ver con el diseño de ciudad y con el tipo de servicios que somos capaces de prestar colectivamente. Hay otra cuestión que yo creo que es muy interesante también y de algún modo se ha comentado, que son algunos de los retos de la técnica para poder abordar las respuestas más adecuadas para cuando en todo caso se necesita utilizar algún vehículo motorizado, ¿no? Entonces, hay muchas preguntas, cuál es el recorrido que todavía tiene el motor de combustión, hay capacidad de mejora o no y combustión de qué. Hay otras alternativas en ese espectro. Hay una capacidad de imaginar otras soluciones que superen el motor de combustión. ¿Hasta qué punto, durante un periodo de transición todavía importante, muy probablemente, sea absolutamente imprescindible electrificar una gran parte de la demanda del transporte? Antes el presidente de Renfe decía que ellos no solamente utilizan, como es obvio, electricidad para satisfacer sus necesidades, sino que han hecho una apuesta, que yo creo que es lo importante, ¿no? Y es electricidad renovable. Es decir, si electrificamos, primero, hacemos un uso lo más ajustado, es decir, conservamos, ahorramos, hacemos un uso eficiente de la energía asociada a las necesidades de movilidad. Y segundo, aquella energía que consumimos tiene un origen limpio, renovable, estaremos cubriendo, por lo menos transitoriamente, una buena parte de ese proceso de cambio que todavía no sabemos cómo va a evolucionar. Yo creo que hay algunas respuestas técnicas que están ahí, el transporte eléctrico, los motores híbridos, se ha venido explorando con otro tipo de cosas que en algunos casos son más prometedoras que en otros, como pueden ser los biocombustibles y según y cómo, o el hidrógeno según y cómo. Es decir, se está explorando todavía qué significa todo esto, cómo se integra, cómo se aprovecha mejor la energía solar directa para algunas necesidades de movilidad. O sea, que yo creo que hay una serie de preguntas que son importantes. Creo en todo caso que hay un tercer factor que es muy, muy interesante y que marcará en gran medida la velocidad a la que se produce ese cambio. Y es cómo este es un nicho que es percibido de una forma atractiva para inducir innovación, empleo, innovación no solamente técnica, sino innovación en el tipo de prestación de servicios, señales de costes y de precios. O sea que hay todo un espacio muy amplio en el que todavía no tenemos todos los elementos para dar una respuesta concreta a tu pregunta, pero donde sí tenemos una idea bastante clara sobre cuáles son los elementos que deben marcar el sentido de la dirección. ¿Qué consumo hacemos? qué alternativas existen para satisfacer nuestras necesidades de movilidad y cómo las gestionamos de una manera mucho más inteligente y hasta qué punto descubrimos que es un espacio enorme, muy rico, para generar una reactivación económica, una capacidad de innovación, una capacidad de generación de empleo diferente y de creatividad que podría dar satisfacción a una demanda que, por otra parte, existe en el mundo industrializado tal como lo conocemos, pero que crecerá de forma exponencial en el mundo en desarrollo y emergente en los próximos años.
I can't give you obviously I can't give you a direct answer on the question when is carbon-free transport possible. I know as a non-expert really in this area, in this specific question, I know that many positive developments are underway. I also know that in some parts of the world, many things are already possible without a car. The car is a very good example. If you live in a big city, it's also my personal experience, when you live in a big city with a good public transport system, most of the time the car is actually a hassle and not a help. So I think there are some positive trends, but I wanted to make actually another point with regard to this question. I think technological solutions, of course, are very, very important, and we need to continue to invest in research and into all kinds of ingenuity to find the right kinds of technological solutions. But I think we also have to say goodbye to the illusion that if we just find the right technological solution, then we can continue to live the way we are living. And I think as important as technological solutions are, they are only, in the end, I think, a very, very small part of the answer. I think when we look at the massiveness of climate change and at the massiveness of the challenge, what you really need deep down, I think, is a very big cultural shift, a very big shift in how we define our values from the everyday life, from the way I consume or what I regard as valuable in my everyday life, up to the level of politics. And I think that is really the decisive shift. And as important as the technological questions are, I think we certainly shouldn't lose sight of these, as far as I'm concerned, much more overarching questions. And of course, from our side, one of the key means to assist this value change and to assist this big cultural change is investing in education, and in the right kind of education, education that really sensitizes people to precisely these issues. And it can mean something as concrete as increasing the amount climate change is addressed in the classroom at all levels of education. So that's really, with regard to that question, the point. Without sort of disrespecting the importance of the technological solutions, the point I really wanted to emphasize: this really a dramatic, massive change in values that we need.
Europa, ayer mismo la Comisión presentó su propuesta de partida para la cumbre de diciembre del clima. Europa quiere, o eso dicen, situarse a la vanguardia y a la cabeza de la lucha contra el cambio climático, y pidió a que el resto del mundo, que todas las emisiones del resto del mundo en 2050 hayan caído a la mitad respecto a los niveles de 1990. Pero la mayoría de gente coincide que la clave del protocolo que va a salir de París, que sustituirá al de Kioto, es la presencia de los dos gigantes, de Estados Unidos y de China, los dos grandes gigantes económicos y los dos grandes gigantes en emisiones. Me gustaría saber qué papel creéis que van a jugar estas dos economías en a partir de ahora.
So first of all, let me just say, Europe is not a leader at the forefront of climate action right now. So the 2020 package, with targets for renewable energy, with targets for emissions and targets for efficiency, that was actually transformative, because that in turn stimulated countries like Germany, and for that matter Spain, to try to change their energy systems, try to incentivize the development of solar and wind. And that in turn caused countries, especially China, to try to capture all of the value in that and to learn how to produce solar panels incredibly cheaply so that now we all can enjoy a solar boom based on that chain of events. Strong action by governments as a group, strong action at the national level, financial incentives to drive change, somebody figuring out how to do it at low cost, tons of solar. That's not where we are in Europe right now, I'm sad to say. And the negotiating platform that came from the Commission yesterday, in our view, is not adequate. Now, having said that, we wouldn't want to underestimate the importance of action by individual European countries. For example, Spain at one point was at the forefront of the renewables industry and could be again if your government had better policies on it. So I'll just leave that there and go back to China and the US. With respect to China, something very big is happening in China. We can all see that the economy is decelerating, right? It's going through this big shift. We don't know exactly what's happening. It's happening very quickly. So some of the data is changing from month to month. But the other thing that we know about China is that China has started to use less coal. Now, if you had talked to any of the people on this panel a few years ago and you had said, we will see peak coal in China by 2020, we all would have, you know, laughed a bit and said that would be great, and yeah, I don't think that's going to happen. But that is actually what seems to be happening. It's not only that the Chinese economy is slowing down, Chinese coal or energy emissions dropped by nearly 3% last year. We expect that emissions, energy-related emissions for 2015 globally will remain flat or increase only slightly, and we'll see a further decline in Chinese coal consumption and also in the emissions from coal in China. Now, that's not just an accident. Again, it's like what happened in Europe with the 2020 package. The Chinese government has really been on the front foot. So they have tried to develop a massive new renewables industry, both for export, but also within their own borders. And they've set very ambitious targets now, actually, for Paris on the percentage of renewables in their total mix. They're also experimenting like crazy with all these issues around transport, high-speed trains, not so successful quite yet, but also electric vehicles and so on. I think it's important also for people such as myself who care a lot about climate change to understand that these shifts that we're seeing in China and in other countries are not only about climate. Right, Teresa mentioned the air quality in Beijing and the very real health concerns that people have about living in very polluted cities, cities that are polluted from coal-fired power, but also from emissions from cars. So there's this, and that those health issues in different cities in China have actually caused social unrest. And if there's one thing that the government of China would like to do, would not like to have too much internal unrest. So we've seen, in addition to the other things I've mentioned, the strong policies from governments, we've also seen Chinese citizens expressing the fact that they would like to have cleaner air, and they're going to get that, I think. Is the Paris Agreement really important for the government of China? Actually, we're not sure about that. What we think is that what's important for the government of China is, A, addressing this transition of their economy, and they've said specifically that they want to transition to this new green economy that we've talked about. This is their top line political goal. B, addressing pollution, especially air pollution. And C, having at least some harmonious relationships with other states that they consider important, and acting on climate is one way to do that. So we think we'll see China coming into the negotiations. We've seen China so far putting things on the table, wanting to show themselves as supporting an agreement, being willing to agree to something coming out of Paris, not wanting to be standing there as they were to some extent after Copenhagen, with others pointing at them saying they caused it. The US. So President Obama has said that climate change is a legacy issue. The US has put targets on the table. Those targets, too, are not adequate. They will need to be improved over time. We have a very strange political situation in the US, but nonetheless, also the US is going to have to improve its targets. What do we think is going to happen there? We're seeing in a lot of countries, the US included, but also in European countries, we're seeing big currents of political change. Not all of those are good, I'll just put it that way. But we're seeing, again, especially amongst younger voters and Latinos, Hispanic voters, that they are very concerned about climate change and they are going to be pushing politicians to deliver far more than they have been able to deliver to date. The US really wants an agreement in Paris. What it doesn't want is an agreement that it has to take through the US Congress, who will reject it because there are many people there who don't believe in climate change. It's very political. We think that they're going to get this kind of agreement and that they will not be taking it through Congress. And that thereafter, you're going to have to see a push on the state level. For example, in California, the legislature has just ordered the two biggest pension funds in California to divest from coal. And they passed a law saying that California must have 50% renewable energy by 2030. So again, things are happening in the US. They're not happening as much as one would like. But it does mean that the US is coming into the Paris negotiations in a different position than it has been in the climate negotiations so far.
James, por favor, muy brevemente, porque nos estamos quedando ya sin tiempo.
After the Copenhagen climate talks, a man called Mark Lynas, who was an advisor to the Maldives in those negotiations and was in the room for some of the discussions, wrote a very interesting piece for us in which he heavily, I mean, there was plenty of blame to go around at Copenhagen for where we ended up. But he heavily put the blame on China through some of its actions and some of its negotiating tactics. It sort of hid behind smaller developing countries to stall agreement. And it did things like sending an official to sit opposite Barack Obama and negotiate rather than Wen Jiabao going himself, which, you know, didn't help to oil the wheels of diplomacy, let's say. The mood music this time around is very different. As Sam has said, there's a lot of action on the ground in China. Things are, you know, the government is genuinely trying to get to grips with this. And you know, if 5 years ago someone had said that they will come out ahead of Paris and commit to peaking their emissions by 2030, which is what's on the table from China, many people would not have believed them. But that is the commitment that is there. So, I'll keep it brief to that and just say that China is in a very different place. There's lots of reason to think that America is also in a better place, and Sam has touched on those reasons. I think there are other countries that could be sticking points, notably India and maybe Russia, but I'll leave it at that.
Teresa.
Yo no iba a referirme a Copenhague, pero dado que tuve el inmenso privilegio de disfrutarlo intensamente y he visto que sirve de referencia para muchas cosas, incluso después de Copenhague pensar, porque le tocaba a España presidir la Unión Europea, en un momento, rápidamente.
Era secretaria de Estado de Cambio Climático en la reunión de Copenhague.
Creo que quizá es pertinente para comparar algunos de los elementos que aquí se han dicho y sacar algunas conclusiones, extraer algunas conclusiones que son importantes, porque me parece que el mundo ha cambiado mucho en parte gracias a Copenhague y se nota, incluido en los temores en estos momentos hacia París. En efecto, yo creo que China en aquel momento jugó una carta de defensor del mundo en desarrollo y el mundo en desarrollo sintió que China la había traicionado porque sus intereses no eran los del resto del mundo en desarrollo más pequeñito y menos desarrollado. Y esto ha cambiado la actitud de China enormemente, que está buscando su perfil como actor internacional también y está dispuesto a contribuir, entiende que debe contribuir, debe ser un referente en, en ese contexto de construcción multilateral, pero quiere ver cómo ocurren las cosas. Creo que también ha cambiado la situación en Estados Unidos y diré que ha cambiado para bien, entre otras cosas porque su presidente ha entendido que dentro de lo que pueden ser sus capacidades en el contexto constitucional de las funciones del Ejecutivo, no pasando por tanto por Congreso y Senado, debe empujar al máximo, de nuevo, por esta conciencia un poco más grandilocuente de cambio de época y, por tanto, en la medida en que constituya y consolide aquello que puede hacer, la responsabilidad política y la crítica política vendrá quien pudiendo no ha hecho y entonces él quiere dejar claro que ha hecho todo lo que puede. Creo que la situación de la Unión Europea ha cambiado, creo que ha cambiado en muchos frentes y que en cambio climático ha sufrido como está sufriendo en otros muchos frentes, es decir, Europa de repente cambió un mensaje y se colocó a sí misma en una situación mucho más tristona en la medida en que pasó de decir yo tengo una idea de cómo quiero construir el futuro, tengo una visión de cómo garantizar una cierta prosperidad para la humanidad y para mi población y cómo reducir determinadas cargas para la sociedad europea, a decir, bueno, como yo ya he hecho mucho, voy a esperar a que los demás hagan tanto como yo antes de dar el siguiente paso. Y eso simplemente la coloca en una situación de mucha mayor irrelevancia como actor internacional. No va a poder competir como, no va a poder marcar un perfil como actor internacional por ser un gran financiador, porque su peso relativo cae, no va a poder ser un gran proveedor de materias primas, por tanto lo que tiene es su prestigio, su capacidad de demostrar que es posible garantizar una cierta estabilidad y una cierta prosperidad, una cierta justicia dentro de sus fronteras y hacia afuera. Eso lo ha perdido, con independencia de que, con todo, pues es interesante ver cómo resulta bastante completo, aunque quede algunos aspectos muy abiertos, las conclusiones que aprobaron ahí en el Consejo de Ministros de Medio Ambiente. Pero me parece que lo más importante de Copenhague, no se ha dicho hasta ahora, lo más importante de Copenhague es que todo el resto de los países de tamaño medio y de tamaño pequeño dijeron bien claramente que en un asunto como este, que es un asunto global, no vale la técnica tradicional en que los grandes se ponen de acuerdo y luego socializan. Ah, no, perdón. De lo que usted haga y decida va a depender mi supervivencia o no. Por tanto, yo quiero un sistema de gobernanza, un sistema de toma de decisión en la que mi interés esté suficientemente representado. No voy a aceptar que me venga diciendo este es el modo en que se ha resuelto el problema. Y esto es un aspecto absolutamente crítico para París. Y es lo que explica en gran medida por qué está siendo tan complicado acabar de armar una solución que encuentre espacio satisfactorio para todo el mundo, incluso para aquellos que son más vulnerables y que sienten que lo que está en riesgo es su propia supervivencia física. A mi juicio fue la gran lección de Copenhague. No hay atajos, no basta con que los grandes se pongan de acuerdo y trasladen. Los más vulnerables, las economías medias, han recibido una llamada. Participe usted en este proceso porque no hay desarrollo posible si no hay un proceso de descarbonización y de construcción de una resiliencia colectiva, pero entiendo que usted quiere tomar parte, como digo, de las decisiones, ¿no? Es decir, si en París salimos sin China o Estados Unidos, fatal, no haremos nada. Pero si en París salimos con África, con los estados insulares, diciendo esto no sirve para nada y no lo acepto, será un fracaso también. Es decir, hay que encontrar la manera en la que se pueda integrar la perspectiva muy diferente de actores que sienten que la gobernanza ha dejado de ser un asunto de los poderosos trasladado a los demás, sino que hay que encontrar la manera de garantizar esa cierta participación en el proceso de toma de decisión.
I'll keep it brief, and I wanted to just of the hugely complex question of the role of US and China, just build on one specific aspect of Teresa's comment. I think when you ask about the major emitters, US and China, what it reminds me of is really one of the huge tragedies of the situation that we're in, and that is that those who are the major emitters are very often not the ones who suffer the most, and those who suffer the most are our small island states in the South Pacific, especially that have climate migration as of today, that observe very extreme weather events with much more frequency, and those are the ones who really have not. Have practically contributed nothing to climate change, and I think that is really one of the big. You can almost call it a tragedy. It adds to the strange situation that often those countries are the ones that then act very quickly on climate change. For example, in my area of work, when it comes to reorienting education systems to integrate the climate issue, it's often those countries. We have big projects in Samoa, for example, or in Tuvalu. Are those countries that are very willing to take our recommendations on board, but ironically they are not the ones who most would need it. They are not the ones who most need it to train their population in sustainable consumption. So I think that's a very important issue to keep in mind, and I very much agree with Teresa that this is also one of the reasons why the whole process is so incredibly complex.
Bueno, me da mucha pena porque me parece interesantísimo, pero no, nos hemos quedado sin tiempo. Muchísimas gracias y a ustedes gracias también, y espero que les haya resultado pues tan interesante como me lo ha parecido a mí. Gracias. Too long.